Hey guys, happy Monday and welcome to another Crime and Conviction. Today is the last of our July theme, which is medical professionals who commit murder. Now, when you think of medical professionals, you think about someone that's supposed to heal you, that's supposed to bring you to health, they're supposed to make you better. But what if one of your family members went into the hospital with something maybe not that serious, and all of a sudden you get a call and hear that your family member is dead? Today we're going to talk about the angel of death, Charles Cullen. Charles was born on February 22, 1960. He was the last of eight children. Charles' family didn't have a lot of money, and the main provider, his 56-year-old father, died when he was just 7 months old. Now, Charles' siblings were older than him, and they would often move out of the house, but somehow they would always find their way back. Now, his brothers would be doing illegal drugs in the home, his sisters would take their boyfriends in the home, and he said that his childhood was very awful because he was abused by his sister's boyfriends, and at school he was bullied. Things got so bad that he attempted to poison one of his sister's boyfriends with lighter fluid, but when this failed, he attempted suicide at just age 9. He drank some chemicals from his chemistry set. This was the first of many suicide attempts. When Charles was in high school, his mother had died, and this was very devastating for him. And when he went to the hospital to retrieve her body, they refused to give it to him, and they said that she had been cremated. So he didn't even get the chance to give his mother a funeral. In 1978, Charles dropped out of high school and enlisted in the army. Things were looking up for Charles in the army. He had passed his psychiatric evaluation, and he had passed all of the tests that he needed to do. But once he was settled, it was like high school all over again because he was bullied by his fellow crewmates. He had multiple mental breakdowns and he attempted suicide once again, and he was sent to the psychiatric ward for several months. 6 years after joining the army, 24-year-old Charles was medically discharged. He enrolled in nursing school, and coincidentally, the nursing school was connected to the hospital that cremated his mother. Things were looking up for Charles at the nursing school. He had friends, he was getting good grades, he was elected the president of his nursing class, and in 1986, he graduated and began to work as a nurse. During this time, he met and married his wife, Andreen, and they had two kids together. Charles' life really took a full 180 from where he began. He had a wife, he had kids, he was doing a job that he liked, which was nursing. But deep down, Charles was truly disturbed. Charles struggled with drinking, and he would abuse the family dogs. Now, there wasn't any claims of abuse towards the children or towards his wife, just the pets. Andreen always had dogs, and she loved dogs. She's an animal person. So when they got together, she had her dogs, she moved in with her dogs and everything, and he would often abuse them. And at one point, they got a puppy together, the whole family, and one day the puppy just went missing. No explanation. It wasn't even just the family dog. One day the neighbor came over to tell Andreen that her dog was missing, and he was later found in a ditch dead. When she took the dog to the vet, the dog had been poisoned. Now, why the neighbor was telling this to Andreen is because the dog would sometimes go over to their house and be in their backyard and stuff like that, and all of a sudden the dog is found poisoned. So 2 and 2 = 4. Andreen was suspicious, but not suspicious enough to leave her husband as yet. In 1988, Charles killed his first patient that we know of. He administered a lethal dose of medication. He continued to overdose his patients, and his victim count flew up to a dozen. What Charles was doing was injecting IV bags with too much medication, and when these IV bags were administered, these people would die. Now, by the time hospital staff found these tainted IV bags, and launched an investigation, Charles was long gone. He moved on to another hospital where he murdered three elderly women. Now, the last woman that he murdered actually complained and said that a strange nurse came into her room in the middle of the night and injected her in her sleep. Now, even though she reported it, nothing was done about it, and the next day she died. Now, as it relates to Charles' home life, by this time his wife had had enough of him, so she asked for a divorce. She took the kids. Charles had to move out of their home, and this sent him into a deep depression. Charles wanted to leave nursing, but he needed the money. He had child support payments to make. In 1993, Charles met a female nurse co-worker, and he got close with her. She was really nice to him, and he definitely took this the wrong way. One day, out of the blue, Charles confessed his love to this female co-worker, and she was so shocked that she didn't say anything to him for the rest of the day. Now, in the afternoon, Charles received a call from her on-again, off-again boyfriend, and he said that Charles needs to leave this woman alone. Charles didn't like this phone call, but it's like he just brushed it to the side. And when he got home, he kept calling her. She would not answer her phone. So this man decided to drive to her home. So he drove to her home, he sat outside, he waited for whatever reason. Then he would drive back home, drive back to her house. He did this a few times, and she lived 40 minutes away. So it would be about an hour and a half each way. And then finally, he broke into her house and he just watched her sleep, and then he went back home. So the next day, the female co-worker probably called her boyfriend about the break-in, and he said he had nothing to do with it. So she called Charles and asked him, you know, my house got broken in, do you have anything to do with this? And this man literally just said, yeah, I was the one that broke into your house. Obviously, this is not something normal, so she called the police, and Charles was arrested for stalking and breaking into her home. He was placed on probation, and then he tried to kill himself again, so he was placed in the psychiatric ward for about 2 months. Charles attempted suicide 2 more times, and with all of these suicide attempts and him being in the psychiatric ward and everything, he remained a nurse. Fast forward, he's out of the psychiatric ward, he's back at work, and a 91-year-old cancer patient made a complaint saying that a nurse snuck into her room, injected her in her leg, and left. Some nurses had checked this cancer patient. They saw an injection mark on her thigh, but they told her that this was a mosquito bite. And the next day, the cancer patient died. The hospital brushed this off, but the son of the cancer patient fought and pushed, and finally the hospital opened an investigation. All of the nurses were questioned, and all of them were given lie detector tests, and surprisingly, Charles passed. Charles worked at that hospital for a whole year after the incident, until he decided that he wanted to leave. He moved on to another hospital and killed about 5 patients, and then he left, moved on to another hospital. So this man was moving from hospital to hospital, just killing people without consequences. At this new hospital, Charles was fired. And you would think he got fired for something serious, right? But nope, poor work habits. Charles was unemployed for 6 months. He went into a deep depression and he sought psychiatric help. Now he realized he wasn't getting a job where he was, so he skipped states, and he had to reapply for his nursing license. And surprisingly, all of the references that he put down gave him good reviews. He found another job as a nurse in a rehab center. Now, while he was there, he overdosed a man that was wearing a neck brace, and he sent him into violent seizures. An investigation was held, and somehow they found an innocent female nurse to be guilty, and they fired her. So she knew for a fact that she did not do this and she wasn't involved in this. So she decided to hire a lawyer and investigate for herself. When the lawyer investigated, he kind of presented to Charles. He gave over all this information to the hospital, the rehab center, but nothing was done. The nurse was never reinstated, nothing. She got no justice. She just had to move on. Charles was eventually fired from this rehab center when he was seen entering a random patient's room carrying some syringes. Now he fought with this patient and the patient ended up with a broken arm or wrist. There's different reports from different sources. At first, everyone thought that this man was just resisting the medication, because people tend to do that in the rehab center. They don't want to get the medication, so they get a bit violent. But upon further investigation, they found out that the medication that he was being administered, he wasn't even prescribed. So they fired Charles. What I find really strange is that this rehab center didn't connect this particular incident with the first incident where they blamed the female nurse. But anyways, no charges were filed or anything, no authorities called. Charles was just fired and he could continue working as a nurse, which of course he did. He killed two different patients at two different hospitals, and when internal investigations were launched, he skedaddled. We're now in the year 2000 and the cycle continued. Charles would try to kill himself, he would seek psychiatric treatment, he would be let out, and then he would return to work as a nurse. Charles found work at a new hospital and he was well liked, because Charles would put in the work. He would come in early, he would leave late. If someone needed to do a double shift, he would volunteer. When it was time for him to switch shifts with someone, he would be there on time, he would get everything right, he was just on point, and everybody liked him, and there was no complaints about Charles. Shortly after Charles came on, medication started to go missing, but the staff would just brush it off and they would replace the medication. Finally, a co-worker caught on to something strange. Now, there's these medical trash bins. I don't really know much about them. All I know is that they are disposed by the hospital. There would be like this medical place that would come and pick them up, say maybe every week. Now it takes a little while for these to be filled up, but the nurse noticed that one of these trash bins was being filled up like really fast. It was really strange. So when she opened this trash bin, she saw empty bottles of this missing medication, and it was weird because the medication wasn't for recreational use and it wasn't a medication that would often be used, but it was a lot. It was like a medication that would paralyze people, so you could be screaming, you can't scream, you can't move, nothing. You're just lying there in freaking pain. It was just too much medication to be accounted for. So what this nurse did is go to another nurse and tell her about what she found and everything, and they decided that they're just going to watch the medication cabinet. They saw nurses go in, they would spend like a short amount of time with the door open, and then they would leave. When Charles went to get some medication, he closed the door behind him, and then he spent longer than all of the other nurses. So they knew that Charles probably had something to do with this. But, and when I say this is the stupidest part of the story, these nurses did not tell anybody else what they were doing. So when they finally discovered what was happening, and them put two and two together, right? Their shift ended. These women went home, and on that very night, someone in the hospital died of an overdose. They came to work, they heard that someone had died from an overdose, and they're just like, oh my gosh, let's go to who we need to go to and tell them what we know. Charles was then called in and given an ultimatum. He would either resign and be given a good recommendation from them, or he would be fired and be given a bad recommendation. And obviously, Charles chose to resign. Now, no authorities was called or anything. They just let this man resign and walk out of the hospital, knowing damn good and well that this man killed somebody that night. With the theft coming to light and all of the nurses finding out what had really happened, some of the nurses decided to call the authorities, but unfortunately, there wasn't enough evidence, so the case was dropped. By what I read and watched, the police really didn't do any intensive investigation in this case. They just kind of did some surface level shit and realized that, okay, we don't have anything on this man, let's just let him go. And obviously, he skipped states again and gained employment again as a nurse. While at this new hospital, the staff noticed his odd behaviors. He would request medication that was not prescribed for his patients. He would access other patients' files that he was not assigned. And sometimes he would be found in different patients' rooms that was not his patient. There were a few overdose cases in this hospital, so poison control was called. And when they did their investigation, they told the hospital that, hey, people are being overdosed on purpose, and obviously a member of staff is doing this, so you guys need to get the authorities involved. Now, the hospital was given this warning in July of 2003, and they waited until October to call the authorities, and during this time, 5 more patients were killed. While the police were trying to do their investigations, the hospital was still being a little bit shady about the whole situation, but they gave the authorities a list with 2 names on it, and one of those names was Charles Cullen. Finally, Charles was being investigated intensively, and when they checked his background, they saw a whole lot of suspicious things. They saw that whenever he worked at a hospital, these debts would kind of skyrocket, and when he left, go back down to the normal rate. The police put surveillance on Charles, but they were having a hard time trying to prove that this man actually killed these people because the hospitals were tight-lipped about the whole situation, trying to avoid lawsuits. When the police went to the hospital that Charles was working at and told them that, hey, we're looking into Charles, they fired him. When he was fired, the authorities really had a fire list under their ass because he could easily skip the state, start working at a new hospital, and just start killing people all over again. So they had to move quickly. He had a close friend at the hospital where he just got fired from, Amy Ridgway. The police had approached Amy to get her to help them to catch him. At first, she refused to believe anything that the police was saying because how can this nice, sweet man harm anybody? That's how she saw him. But the police had to show her all the evidence that they had on him, and she was so shocked, but she decided to help the police. They used her to get information from the hospital, information that the hospital would not give, like records and stuff like that, and they also asked her to wear a wire whenever she was talking to Charles. On December 12th, 2003, Amy met up with Charles at a restaurant, and she was not playing. She straight up looked at this man and said, I know that you are the ones killing these patients. And she said that his face was so shocked. But she quickly went into character and she's just like, I don't care about that. I'm there for you. I care for you. And if you turn yourself in, I'll be standing by your side 100% of the way. And Charles' exact response to this statement was, I'm not going down without a fight. And when the police heard this, because, you know, Amy was wearing her wire, they knew that this man was the man that was killing all of these patients. Charles was arrested and the police brought him in, but all they had was circumstantial evidence, and they were worried that this man could walk free. So they asked Amy for some help again. And she went in to talk to him and she said that the police are investigating her and trying to pin all of the murders on her. So because he cared for her and he did not want this to happen, he decided to confess. On December 14th, 2003, 2 days after he was arrested, he confessed to about 2 murders. But then the police kept pushing and pushing and pushing, and this man admitted to almost 40 The police could only prove 13 murders, so Charles was offered a plea deal where he would help the police to identify all of his victims. This man really couldn't identify everybody that he killed, so his information was essentially useless. And when the investigation stopped in 2006, he was given 11 life sentences. Charles refused to speak at his sentencing hearing, and he never expressed any remorse to the victims' families. He never gave any explanation for what he did until he did an interview with 60 Minutes in 2012. Charles said that these were essentially mercy killings because he didn't want these patients to suffer anymore or go into cardiac or respiratory arrest. He couldn't bear to see all of these doctors and nurses hovering over the patients trying to save them if they were supposed to go into the arrest, right? But this was a big fat lie because some of the freaking people that this man killed weren't even terminally ill. The number of persons that Charles has killed is undetermined. It could be 40, it could be 400. He worked at multiple hospitals, and because these hospitals tried to save themselves from lawsuits and stuff like that, most of the files had been destroyed. Because of what Charles did, it changed hospital laws in the US, and they're now stricter with who they hire, and they require background checks, which is crazy to me because that wasn't required before. Anyways, the last update that I saw of Charles was in 2018, and he's still in prison, he's still alive, which I find crazy because he has attempted suicide so many times. You'd think that he would kill himself in prison. But anyways, that's all the information that I have for you guys today, and now it's time for my thoughts. I think it's pretty cut and dry for me. This man is just a madman. He had no reason to kill these people. I think he had just gotten satisfaction from this whole situation. And the other thing that I want to say is these hospitals are shit. They don't look out for anybody but themselves. Because if you have a freaking nurse that's killing people and you know this or suspect this, why would you have this man move on to another hospital? Why would you give him glowing recommendations? You could have called the authorities and stopped this man in his shoes. This man was, he was literally given the go-ahead to kill people. And in his interview with 60 Minutes, he did blame the hospitals. And even though I don't agree with most of what this goddamn man had to say, that I agree with, because the hospitals let him get away with it. Anyways, guys, that's it for the video today. The link to my sources will be in my description box. Also, my social media links are down there. I know you guys have opinions. Leave them down in the comment section. Give me a thumbs up or a thumbs down. I don't know how you're feeling today. And as per usual, remember to be a beautiful soul, not just a gorgeous face. Enjoy the rest of your week. And until we see each other next time, bye. Now, 6 years after joining...